Hello, my name is Rick Schmidlin. I produced the re-edit of this version of Touch of Evil that you are about to see, and I welcome you to this commentary. On December 5th, 1957, Orson Welles went to Universal Studios to screen a version of Touch of Evil. He watched the film without taking one note and just watched the film and thought about what he had seen. He went home that night furiously mad and wrote a 58-page memo that he sent to the studio the next day, asking them to make editorial changes. The studio did not honor this memo. Thanks to Alan Davio and Jonathan Rosenbaum, who brought this to my attention, I was able to convince Universal Studios to allow me to re-edit this film. What we are now watching is the opening scene. It's a very famous shot that extends without an edit. The studio was unhappy with the opening shot and put credits over it in the other versions you have seen, and a Henry Mancini score. This was not what Welles wanted. Now, I called Universal Studios and asked them what else did they have in their vaults when I started this project. And they said, well, we have nothing except a textless opening that is to be used for international release so we can put international credits on. So thanks to Mike Fitzgerald at Universal Studios at the time, we were able to put this together. What was very interesting about this was it was from an original negative, so we were able to find the sound elements. So when you heard that whistle just now, and when you hear some of the background, this came from Welles' original track. What we were able to do is incorporate through Welles' sound notes, which I will discuss later, some elements that gave you the whole sounding appeal of it coming alive. This was something that was very interesting, and Walter Murch did an extraordinary job on that. What was really great is that I was able to have Walter Murch work on this project and edit this project for me. Walter, most of you know, had worked with Francis Ford Coppola and been involved in films like The Conversation, Julia, Apocalypse Now, American Graffiti, and had recently done The English Patient right prior to this project. And I felt that Walter really understood sound design because that is where he came from. So Walter was basically instrumental in putting the scene back together in an audio context that we could really understand Welles' intentions. The other nice thing was that we had Bob O'Neill at Universal Studios who worked in the preservation vaults, and Bob was able to find the best elements. So what we found for the original release version, a negative that had all the multi-track sound elements in it. Now, I was very lucky to get Walter Murch involved in this project. I had just seen Walter Murch speak at the Los Angeles County Museum on sound design. Based on that lecture, I contacted Ian Burney, who was the director of the film program at Los Angeles County Museum. He gave me Walter's number, and I was able to call Walter and ask if he would want to be involved in this project. I will go into that in more detail later. But Walter did an extraordinary job working with this. He understood every element of Welles' sound motif. And because we were able to find Welles' sound memos along with the 58-page memo, and that was thanks to Frank Brady, a biographer of Welles who had found this material through Ernest Nims, who was a head of post-production at Universal at the time, we were able to bring this whole original soundtrack alive, as Welles had intended. Now, one thing you have to remember about watching this version of Touch of Evil, this is not Orson Welles' version of the film. What this is an attempt to honor the 58-page memo to the best of our ability. I set up a certain criteria that was very important. First, we would only honor the memo up to the memo. So if anyone made any statements or interviews after about how Touch of Evil should have been, that would not be addressed. It had to be addressed based on this memo or anything written prior. The other thing is I wanted to make sure that this was an ethical project. So I brought Jonathan Rosenbaum, a noted Wellesian scholar, to the project. I wanted to keep this project academically correct so that it could be studied in such a format as we are doing right now. And I knew that if Jonathan was involved as the studio watchdog, as he liked to refer to himself as, that we would be able to honor Orson's requests to the best of our ability. Now, for all you cinephile people out there, think about this. Jean-Luc Godard's favorite film critic is calling the editorial decisions for Universal Studios and deciding if the film is suitable for your viewing pleasure or not. Ha ha ha, now we're having fun, aren't we? So we got Walter Murch, we got Jonathan Rosenbaum, and we're now following Orson's plan.
I mean, this business.
I'm afraid so. That bomb came from the Mexican side of the border. The car did. Bomb.
Tengo un mensaje para usted.
We're understanding now, during this part of the film, his cross-cutting technique. When I asked Ernest Nims, the head of post-productions, why they originally had the Vargas scene with Quinlan and then the Susie Grandy scene separated, he said, if you cross-cut the way Wells wanted, it would be more confusing for the audience. Well, from what I understand, and you are the audience, I don't think you are confused. I think you're finding a much more coherent story, and it's much more alive as you're watching what's going on basically on both sides of the border. And you're understanding that there is two different stories here. In the original release version, this is very unclear, and we will look at elements of that later. And in the preview version, this is, again, very, very, very unclear to us. What we have is two different stories. Another thing that a lot of people have asked me is, why are we watching it in 1.85? Why isn't it full frame? Well, Wells wanted to shoot it in 1.85. That's what he had seen as a format that was becoming widespread in Europe. The reason it was shot in full frame is Lou Wasserman, who was really a hero in this project, both in its original version and in the re-edit, felt that television was becoming a big thing and that films like Touch of Evil and then Psycho should be shot full frame, and then they could be shown in a matted frame in the movie theaters. So Wells had composed the film to be in 1.85. It was composed also to be in a full frame for movie theaters. This is not something that's altogether that different when we think about how films are being presented on airplanes these days. It's the same mentality, but they were thinking television, and I'm going to show you something at the end of the film where television does come into play within this film in a big way. Universal was very much interested in television, and they bought the 1930s and 1940s library from Paramount so that they could exploit it for television. That was during the old MCA days, so they were television savvy.
Hey, ladies, look at the pretty baby.
Now, let's get back into a little about what we're going to see here and what we're doing. Right now, the original release version came from a negative that had the sound separation. The preview version, which is the other version that we have, the longer version, did not have the sound separation. So we only had sound separation for the shorter version. So only in certain elements could we change the sound.
I guess. This note says you have something for my husband.
Yeah?
One of the things that's interesting about the scene we're watching with Grandy and Susan is we've got Pancho, Valentin de Vargas, in the back there. There was one shot that you, if you go back to your other versions and take a look at, you will see that he's leaning against the wall. Wells asked for that rather bad shot to be taken out. He said it was a good attempt, but the shot basically held up the scene and was a showstopper. And it's true. Just a match shot of Valentin de Vargas against the wall was a showstopper. That's the only thing we took out of this scene.
The name ain't Mexican. I got a permit for this thing. Grandy family is living here.
We tried to keep everything correct. What's also interesting is that there were a lot of rips and tears between both productions. And originally when we had a budget for this project, we had a budget of approximately $325,000, which was much less than they had for Vertical a couple years prior to this, which was over $1 million. So we were basically only hired to do the re-edit. We were not going to do picture restoration in great detail. We were not going to do digital repair. But Jim Waters, president of Universal Studios Operations, saw the film after we re-edited it and gave us an extra $40,000 to go to Pack Title and go to Phil Finer and have digital restoration done to the film, so we were able to correct all these rips and tears. That was a blessing for all of us, so that we really do see Touch of Evil in its best form, and we see it restored, basically, not for video, but for film, with all the bells and whistles that we could get together.
Tea, man. Quiet little tea party, all for Rudy Lennox's bonfire. Yeah, I hear he even invited some kind of a Mexican.
Oh, I don't think Mr. Vargas claims any...
Let's discuss now, how did this project happen? How did Touch of Evil come into being? Universal Studios called me back in the early 90s and said that they were going to do special edition laser discs. And was there a laser disc I would like to do? And I told them Touch of Evil. That was the film. I was a Wellesian fan. I loved this film. And I thought it would be interesting to try to get Janet Leigh and Charlton Heston, possibly Dennis Weaver, back together to discuss what the true story was, why the Wells film was as incoherent as it was. Thinking that here we had a 42-year-old Orson Welles at the top of his game, a brilliant man, and the film just didn't make all that much sense, especially the release version. The preview version wasn't that much better either. So what could we do? Well, Universal Studios told me first I had to do a project for The Doors. For years, I had worked with the band The Doors, doing all their home videos. And we put together a special edition Laserdisc called The Doors Collection. And after that, I was supposed to be able to get a project that I wanted to do from their library, but that didn't happen. So for about 3 years, I badgered the studio. And I would get together about once every 6 months with Louis Fiola, who was president of Home Video, in a little coffee shop in the San Fernando Valley, and he would sit down and he'd say, how are things going, Rick? And I would say, well, things are going well, but what about Touch of Evil? And it got a little overbearing, I think, because the breakfast started becoming once a year, and even though Louis and I were still close and I had done a few more projects for them, Touch of Evil just was not happening. In 1996, I produced a documentary called The Third Mind about beat poetry, about the fusion of jazz and poetry with Ray Manzarek from The Doors and poet Michael McClure. And it was actually the first documentary for the Sundance Channel. It was literally their first special documentary. And that was pretty exciting. And I premiered it at the Venice Film Festival. And at the Venice Film Festival, I met my partner, lifelong partner, who is here with me now, Francesca Marini. And she was from Bologna, Italy, and she came to visit me in Los Angeles. And because she was Italian, and Louis was an Italian-American who was very much into that culture and lifestyle, he said, let's get together for dinner and let's meet Francesca. So all of a sudden, it was not a breakfast, it was a dinner, and it was a nice restaurant. And we got together with Louis and Susie Peterson, who was, again, another very important person in the home video department. And Louis came in fashionably about 30 minutes late, greeted us, and before he even sat down, he said, Rick, I want to let you know one thing. We're not going to discuss Touch of Evil. I'm here to meet Francesca and have a nice meal and just have a good time. Touch of Evil is not the discussion tonight. But in the next couple days, I'm having a meeting with the executives at the studio, and they want to talk about future film preservation projects and release projects for the theatrical division, and I'm going to mention Touch of Evil. If there is an interest, I'll give you a call. Don't count on it, but, you know, I will bring it up. And that was basically where it was left off. Remarkably, 2 days later, I wasn't home. Francesca was there. She got the phone call, and we got the green light.
The key to this whole thing is the dynamite. The killer didn't just want Lineker dead. He wanted him destroyed, annihilated.
Over here, Vargas. We're going in the back way. Señor Vargas. Señor Vargas.
Yes?
The scene that we're watching now, it's interesting because In the preview version, it's shorter. In the release version, it's longer. And what Universal Studios did was when they released the home video and Laserdisc version of the Touch of Evil originally, they took from the release version this extended scene and added it in with the preview version to make it longer. Another thing that's coming up right now that I think is interesting is in the both versions, the preview and the release, you always hear the music as the band's just coming down the stairs. But here when we hear that the show's over, the music stops, and now we see the band coming down. That was part of Wells, again, sound motif. He wanted you to feel that everything was alive. He wanted very little overscoring, as we will notice in this picture. He wanted all the sound elements to come from an actual source.
Pianola.
Hey, we go this way, you know.
As we now discover, we will hear the pianola, which plays a very important part in that kind of scoring. It sets the mode for the time, and it sets a past for Wells. So we've heard the radios and the cars and everything in the beginning, and now we're hearing this older sound, a sound that came from many years before, and something that he's very familiar with. And this is where we're going to meet the great Marlene Dietrich. Now think of it, film fans out here. Here I was, another film geek in the audiences with you guys, going to these restoration films and going to, you know, cinema houses and joining cinema clubs and collecting millions of movies and watching Z Channel when it was on and just going nuts. And now I'm working on an Orson Welles film with Marlene Dietrich in it. How cool can it be? This was really an exciting moment for me. That was one thing I have to say is, working with such a cast, even if it was a film that was shot 40 years prior to when I started this project, it had all my favorites in it. The other thing was, it was really great because I got to spend some really quality time with Charlton Heston, who told me not to call him Mr. Heston or Charlton, but call him Chuck. Janet Leigh, who made me call her mom throughout all the publicity of this film. Valentin de Vargas, who was as frightening off-screen as he was on. Wonderful guy. I like Valentin a lot. And Dennis Weaver. And later on, I'll tell you an extraordinary story about Dennis. Dennis was a very, very nice man. To be able to be involved in this kind of production, it was very, very special.
Anyway, you're sure looking good.
You a mess, honey.
Yeah. That pianola sure brings back memories.
The customers go for it. It's old, it's new.
When I was working on this film with Walter Murch, we were editing it up in a farmhouse in Northern California where he does all his work, and I will not disclose the location because I don't want you all going up there to visit him, you know, and try to bring projects to him, and, you know, he deserves his privacy, so we won't talk about where he is in Northern California, but he's somewhere in Northern California. And I was reading in Frank Brady's book on Wells that Wells had written sound notes. So one day while Walter was editing this film, I was playing on the internet, and I checked on the AOL White Pages, Ernest Nims. And believe it or not, I found Ernest Nims, who was a head of post-production at Universal Studios at the time of this film, who was in charge of this film, and had also been the editor of The Stranger, who had worked with Wells, was alive and well and living in Culver City. And I called Ernest up on the phone and I said, "Hi, Ernest, this is Rick Schmidlin. I'm producing a re-edit of Orson Welles' Touch of Evil." And he said, "Well, I don't know what was wrong with it. I liked it the first time it came out. It wasn't a great movie, but it did okay." And I said, "Well, we're going to do a re-edit." And he goes, "Oh, that's no problem. That should be a lot of fun for you guys to do." And, you know, he was just a really nice guy. And I said, "Do you have anything on Touch of Evil that we don't have? All we have is the 58-page memo." And he goes, "Oh, I got my box upstairs. I've got all the sound notes, all the memos, all the letters, all the correspondence. Everything's upstairs. Do you want to take a look at it?" And I think my jaw dropped. I told Walter, "Guess what we just found?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, I'm going out to play some golf. I just had a triple bypass, but my doctor said I can play golf, so I'm going to go out and play some golf. I'll leave the box on the front doorstep. My address is... And I panicked. And I said, well, I'm in Northern California. She said, well, have the studio pick it up. And he was just like, you know, like he was back in the game. Just have the studio pick it up. So I called Paul Hardart, who was our point person at Universal at that time, and said, we have a box in Culver City sitting on a doorstep. We have to get it right away. And so Paul sent a driver over. They picked the box up. They brought it to Universal Studios. So here, Walter and I were editing Touch of Evil in Northern California, and Walter had a fax machine. And all of a sudden, we started getting notes, sound notes, editorial notes, extra notes through the fax machine as if they were coming from Orson himself, along with letters and correspondence. And it was telling us, do this, do that, edit this three frames shorter here, extend this here, do this. It was an amazing thing. It was like we were actually getting notes from Wells. If you read the book Conversations with Walter Murch, he'll explain it in more detail, and I think that makes an exciting read. Michael Odonce did a fantastic job with this book. Michael Odonce, who is known for writing The English Patient, was really intrigued with working with Walter Murch. What he felt with The English Patient was that he was the first author and Walter was the last author by editing the film version. And in homage to Walter, he did this extraordinary book. I wrote two pages in the book about my experiences with Walter, but I think if you really want to understand Touch of Evil and Walter Murch, if you don't already have a copy of this book, and I'd be surprised if most cinephiles don't already have it on the shelves, run out, go to the bookstore, buy one. They're everywhere. One of the most important books you can read on film editing. So we get these notes from Ernest Nims, and now it gets kind of exciting. Walter starts reading the notes, and all of a sudden I see a tear in his eye, and he's swelling up. And I had never seen him really emotional. And he said, I don't believe it. And he called his wife, who was downstairs. Walter works in a barn, or a renovated barn, and his wife was in the house. And he said, Aggie, come upstairs. I have to tell you something. And Aggie comes up, and Walter goes, I can't believe it. I can't believe what we just found. He thought when he worked on The Godfather, he had invented a process called wordizing. He'd worked on it with American Graffiti and The Godfather both, which is where you would record music and sound, play it back through bad speakers, and re-record that. And that's what you would hear on the screen. And in these memos, Wells was discussing these radio recordings that we hear, the car radios and the different recordings from the speakers and things, that he wanted them to be recorded. And then what he realized was that something he thought he had invented was actually invented by Orson Welles. That Orson was really the inventor of wordizing, not Walter Murch. And it bonded the two together. It bonded them in a way that really came alive in this project. One of the things that Walter was interested in originally with sound design was growing up, he loved radio. And he loved the old radio stories that he would listen to as a child. And one of the things that Wells did when he made Citizen Kane and kept right through Touch of Evil was he worked with sound design in a way he would work with radio. So he told the story in an audio way as well. So that's why radio elements and sound effects are as important to a Wells film as the actual picture is.
All right, you.
Oh, what a setup to work with. One brother in jail, two others dead. Nobody left to carry on the business but a bunch of nephews.
Listen,
don't
I'm...
do that!
You locked the rug, Uncle John.
Off of you two went behind the ears.
You locked the rug. This isn't the real Mexico, you know that. All border towns bring out the worst in a country.
I can just imagine your mother's face if she could see our honeymoon hotel.
Señor Vargas.
Momento. Does this mean you're taking that early plane back to Mexico?
Telefono.
Telephone.
Because it doesn't leave for another 2 hours. All I can say is, if you are taking that plane, I'm very glad.
I'm very glad you're very glad.
See?
I've been asked, is there anything you added to the film that wasn't already there? And the answer is yes. We did do one thing. We found out in the original script that Wells wanted a radio broadcast for Grandy to listen to in his car so that we had an idea why Grandy was chasing Janet Leigh and Charlton Heston. And the what we wanted to do is keep the story alive of Grandy's brother in Mexico City. So basically, we found the original script with the sound notes that told us what Wells wanted in the broadcast. We brought in a Hispanic radio broadcaster, recorded it in a studio at Universal, then played it back through speakers, re-recorded it through some bad car speakers, and that's what you hear in the car when you see Grandy chasing these characters in a minute. So basically, this is the element of Wells and radio that's very important.
I don't know. I was told to put this in your hands.
Susie.
Mike, look at
that. That was the police.
The scene that's coming up now is probably the most important to the film as far as the reconstruction and as important to what was found in the preview version. Basically, what happens here in the release version, as you've seen, is they get in the car, and the next thing you know that they cut to the hotel, and there's Janet Leigh and Dennis Weaver. And there is no car driving scene. There is no scene where they have this dialogue. And there's no scene where Menzies intervenes with Wells and picks up Janet Leigh and Heston gets in the car with Wells. This doesn't happen. This scene was found in the preview version. And this is why everyone thought it was Wells' long-lost version of Touch of Evil, because there was more. What is very obvious as we watch the scene is that it's got a match shot in the back, and that it was shot by Harry Keller. So this was one of the most famous shots, the November shots, that what I like to refer to them as the shots that were not done by Wells. So in a few seconds, you'll see them driving along with the radio, which is in Wells' original design, but you have this match shot that looks like every match shot that every 1940s film had, a 1930s film with from Hollywood. So here we got the radio here. Now, let's watch as Akim Tamroff gets into his car. Now, when he gets in the car, he turns on the radio. Now, this, again, something we had to add into the film to give a sense that there was a radio on in his car. So, watch this.
Why, well, he's never been born.
Car has started, radio's on, and he's off. This is something else that Wells asked for in the re-edit. Now, listen to this music. This is a wonderful, romantic Henry Mancini score, The Honeymoon Couple, with the famous match shot. And I want you to watch this because you're going to see the original Palmdale shots. Wells had originally shot scenes with Heston and Leigh in Palmdale driving a car, but these shots have been lost, so we didn't have those elements to work with. But when Wells did see the preview version that had these shots, when he watched the film December 5th, he had seen these match shots and did not object to them. These were not shots that he said take out. He only had shots taken out that he felt were not pushing the story forward. If he felt that a shot like this pushed the story forward, he didn't object to it. He was trying to play ball the best he could. And as Heston says, he basically was a little too brash. Look at this. These are the Palmdale shots. These are the shots that were shot from what Wells originally wanted. Also, you just heard the radio. That was the radio broadcast I talked about. The reason that people like Andre Bazin and Francois Truffaut and Peter Bogdanovich, Jean-Luc Godard, and everybody else was confused about the plot line of Touch of Evil in the original version was this scene didn't exist. So we never did see Charlton Heston leave and go into the car with Wells. We never saw Joseph Calera get in the car with Janet Leigh. Again, here's another thing that Wells asked for in the film. When he gets in the car, in the preview version, you'll notice there's no music. They're just driving. In the re-edited version, the version that we did, watch this.
right, Mr. Vargas, this how. He was wounded.
We've got the music again. And now, it sets the mood. It's putting her to sleep. And rather than being in the car with her handsome husband driving along to a hotel, they're now driving along. Here's the radio broadcast again, by the way. And now cut to the romantic music. Is this a nightmare or what? 1 minute she had Charlton Heston, now she has Joseph Calera. This is Palmdale. This is where the original shots were first filmed. It's funny, I had a friend of mine, Roy Noble, who's a guitar builder, who lives in the Palmdale area. And I used to go out and visit him, and believe it or not, I used to have to drive down this very road, and I would pass the motel where Touch of Evil was shot. It was one day I pulled in the parking lot. I couldn't believe it. It was that motel. And here we are. So if you drive out to Palmdale, and you're in California, you want to go on a Touch of Evil trip, you have to go down and visit the motel. And this is the motel that basically gave the same idea for Alfred Hitchcock for Psycho. He wanted this kind of desolate thing. So it's all basically a little stolen. Think of it this way, too. Psycho, Janet Leigh, and this time Dennis Weaver, but is Dennis Weaver all that different than Norman Bates? Let's take a look and see what happens.
Nowhere.
You're coming with me.
On what charge?
I don't know yet. That's for Captain Quillen to decide.
Well, what was
Can you imagine this was not in the version that anyone had seen when the film came out and no one had seen these scenes until 1972, when Bob Epstein at UCLA requested a print and wound up with a longer version? Unbelievable. And Akim Tamaroff, I mean, any scene with Akim Tamaroff, I think he is probably one of the greatest character actors of the 40s and 50s. I just love every time I see him on screen. The scene with Dennis Weaver is fantastic. And I want to talk a little about Dennis Weaver and share a little story with you because it is with Dennis Weaver and it is with Janet Leigh. We first premiered this film in 1998 at the Telluride Film Festival. And if you haven't gone to the Telluride Film Festival, it's one of the nicest film festivals you could ever attend in North America. I highly recommend it. It's well worth the money and the long weekend. And I was really excited. Telluride was a great adventure. I got there and, I mean, I was in a movie theater and I get up one day and I look behind me and there's Clint Eastwood and I meet John Borman and it was just a, you know, one of these magical, magical places. Peter Bogdanovich was the guest director and I was hanging out with Peter and he was telling me Wells stories. It was quite exciting. So all of a sudden, one night we're having the premiere of Touch of Evil and this is the world premiere. And there's a line around the block, and it's a sold-out event, and there's Roger Ebert, and everybody's there, and I see Todd Saldance going in, and it's like, it's a, you know, it's a hot night. And all of a sudden, here comes a vehicle that pulls up, I can't remember what it was, and out of the vehicle pops a man and a woman dressed in identical cowboy outfits. I mean, rhinestone cowboy outfits, the hats, the, you know, I mean, dressed to the hilt, and it's Dennis Weaver and his wife. Dennis Weaver comes up. The director said, you have to meet Dennis Weaver. He just showed up. And I found out he lived in Telluride, Colorado, heard the Touch of Evil was being shown, didn't know about the re-edit, but knew it was going to be shown through the newspapers. And he and his wife had just done some charity benefit where they did a husband and wife cowboy thing and came right over to the theater, fully dressed in costume, to see the film. So all of a sudden, there we had Dennis Weaver meeting him for the first time. I was there with Janet Leigh. Dennis had not seen Janet Leigh since the making of the film. So it was a major, major emotional scene. And you couldn't believe what it felt like that night. What was very interesting was Dennis Weaver wrote a book, his autobiography, a few years later. And I saw it at the bookstore and I started looking through it. And I couldn't believe it. He mentioned me, and he mentioned Touch of Evil, and he mentioned that whole night and what it meant to him. As I say, Dennis is with Janet and Charlton now in the heavens with Orson, and, you know, I just have to say thank you, Dennis. I cried like a baby when I saw that you brought that story in the book. It was quite something, and I couldn't believe it.
You fired anybody lately? I figured you'd be asking about that.
Yeah, a boy named Sanchez?
Sure. He's been playing around with the boss's daughter.
Say, Captain, I just recognized somebody over there at the blaster.
Oh, with the big ears?
Our office prosecuted that guy for voluntary manslaughter.
Get him over here. That's Eddie Farnham.
Got you.
5 to 10.
You have to get out of here. We're going to blast
again. How long have you been out?
3 months.
Quick parole.
Who got you this job?
My lawyer, Howard Franz.
Come in, car 10.
Grandy's lawyer.
Come in, car 10. Suspect now in custody at 5.
Well, this is it.
Suspect?
This is a scene that is now married together that wasn't married together before. Again, look at the preview version and watch Wells' sound design and see how, with the explosion of the dynamite there, works beautifully with the police siren. Now, one of the things that Wells wanted and why he wanted this to work is he talks about when he's in the car, Wells, about the lawyer, Howard Franz. Workman says, I got off with my lawyer, Howard Franz. This is what Wells intended. This is a good example of the clarity Wells wanted in the memo.
He was that slick lawyer that got Farnham a parole.
He was Rudy Lineker's attorney, too.
Isn't that Quinlan?
Quinlan.
And who do we meet?
I figured we'd have Aunt Quinlan to deal with.
Howard Franz.
I've heard about that.
The same lawyer that got him off. The story comes together. Before they were separated, when you hear the workmen talk about Howard Franz, there's a delay between these scenes in the preview version. So you really don't connect or think about Howard Franz being this kind of special lawyer that gets, you know, criminals off on a better charge. So basically this is, we understand that he's kind of a sleazy lawyer. And that's what Wells wanted.
Do we play around first with a few nasty questions, or does he get out the rubber hose?
I'm sure my colleagues have discussed this shot, you know, in great detail, so I'm going to try to give you some new information from what I know. First, when I asked cinematographer John Bailey, who's a good friend of Alan Davio and mine, what was the most important shot in Touch of Evil, he always felt this was a much more important shot than the opening shot as far as an extended shot by Wells. And I want to just mention very briefly here about his wife, Carol Littleton. When I was looking for an editor, I called and consulted her about Walter Murch, and Carol's line was, he's the best if you can get him. And Carol later on, I found out, is also the best because when I produced the reconstruction of the lost story narrative of Eric von Stroheim's Greed, Carol worked with me. So they really were important to me as far as, again, filmmakers who understood what I was doing and helped me be guided in the right direction. Now, what's interesting about this is the first day of shooting of Touch of Evil. This was shot February 19th, 1957. The starting time, the first for the shooting call, was at 9 o'clock on stage 19. The first scene we saw in the window was shot between 10:05 and 10:35. Ernest Nims called Ed Mull and said, 10:35, Wells had the first shot in the can. And everybody was happy. It was scene 79C. Then, between 10:35 and 12:54, there was a rehearsal with the cast. And at 12:54 to 1:54, lunch. Everybody was getting a little nervous. Wells had not done anything else except rehearse for the rest of the morning. At 1:54, to 2:15, there was a rehearsal with the cast. From 2:15 to 2:20, they did some wild tracks. From 2:20 to 6:05, there was more rehearsal. And from 6:05 to 6:25, they were working on makeup. Phil Bowles, assistant director, talked to Ernest Nims. They called Ed Mull and said that Wells had not gotten anything else in the can, that he was way behind schedule, that the next shot was not done, and that basically they were getting concerned that this was going to be a big mistake and maybe they should pull production, that Wells was up to his old tricks. He was going to rehearse and rehearse and rehearse and not shoot. At 6:25, Wells started to shoot scene 86B, shooting 13 and a half pages on his first day. Almost unheard of by any director in Hollywood at that time. One of the interesting things when I worked on the project is I asked Ernest Nims if there was anyone else alive, and he said, well, Eddie Mull was in his 90s and living in the San Fernando Valley, but I could call him. I think I was the last person that was doing research on a film about Universal that was able to talk to Ed Mull because he passed away about 3.5 weeks or 4 weeks later. I asked Ed Mull what he thought about Wells' first day of shooting. And Ed Mull, who was very much into the Doris Day Rock Hudson films of the time and had been responsible for films like The Creature of the Black Lagoon and was very much an advocate of Douglas Sirk and did not really think fondly of Wells, just said to me, Orson, he was just showing off. That was the studio attitude of day one of Touch of Evil, that Orson had created one of the great shots in cinematography history, which all the great cinematographers to this day still marvel. If you look at films like Goodfellas with Martin Scorsese and many, many other films, this is the forefront of what was used with Steadicams and everything else, and Wells was perfecting it in 1957. So the studio's attitude was showing off.
Oh, there's my coffee. Didn't you bring me any donuts or sweet rolls?
You'll have to put him on the scene of the crime.
We will.
You've got to have some evidence.
We'll get it. Well?
Well, you didn't ask me to get any donuts, Captain.
Where are you going?
This is not my case, Captain.
What finally convinced you of that?
This is not my country, that's all. I'm not convinced.
Well, ain't that a shame?
There's another phone near here, right across the street.
Here we are on the streets of Venice, California, where I live very nearby after Touch of Evil, and where directors like Curtis Hanson still live, and Wells was shooting on location. I love this shot here, by the way. I just have to point out this is one of my favorite shots in the film.
Hello, I'd like the telephone number of the Mirador Motel.
What is this place you're taking me to? Now listen, this is ridiculous.
Now go on.
Who's this?
Who are you? Don't push. Where's Captain Quillen?
He's in there making a search.
What am I doing in here?
Oh, Hank.
What's the idea of barging in on me like this?
I'm sorry,
Hank. What you got in here?
I forgot to give you your cane.
All right, sit down.
Queer thing, Hank. When I was taking Mrs. Vargas to the motel, I picked this guy on the way.
No, no, it's Uncle Joe Grandy. Why'd you bring him in here?
For some crazy reason, he was following me in his car.
He was tailing you?
Yeah.
Why would I be following a cop? He's an idiot.
Maybe because you thought he was a Mexican cop, because you thought he was Vargas. He was driving Vargas's car. Oh. Right?
So you're right. So I thought I was following Vargas. So what?
Sit down.
It's a free country.
Shut up.
Yes, it's the Mirador Motel, and it's me.
Oh, darling, the news is...
Now, let's get into how the project started and some working with Universal a little. I have to say that Mike Fitzgerald was very instrumental in helping and giving me information in the beginning. And then there was a fellow there named Bob O'Neill. And Bob was one of those good old boys, you know, as he liked to refer to himself. He was one of those guys who loved working at the studio and... He basically was the head of the vault services and charge of film preservation. And Bob was very important in this project. And when I got the green light for Touch of Evil, after reading the memo, well, let me tell you about the green light. That's even good. Bob calls me up and says, we have to have a meeting. And we're meeting with the guys up in the tower. This was after I had done the pitch, I had written a proposal and everything else. And I get this call from Bob and I show up in probably one of the worst suits ever. And Bob and I go up in the tower, and we meet with Jim Waters, and Louis Viola's there, and Paul Hardart, who was our point person, and Chris McGuirk, who was a big guy at the studio at the time. They were all there, and there were about four or five other guys. Lou Costello, which was another executive there. And I made my pitch, in the tower, in this office, with about seven or eight, as I say, executives all staring at me. And I think the pitch lasted all for about 2 minutes. And Chris McGuirk, who was in charge of picture production at the time, said, okay, let's do it. And they all walked out of the room. So there I am in this really terrible suit, standing in an office in the tower. And I looked at Bob and said, you know, is this it? Is this, you know, how a picture gets made? And he goes, that's how you got the green light. You're making a movie now, kid. And all of a sudden, that was how it was made. And it was, you know, there was no, like, talking back and forth and what if or what. It was just, okay, that sounds good. Let's do it. And then everybody went off to do their different things. People went off to lunch, play golf, or whatever they went to do, but they just left. So I said to Bob, I said, do I have any choice in who I hire? And Bob said, well, we got this one editor that used to work with this famous director, and he, you know, we were thinking of getting him back, and a lot of people like him, and he hasn't been on the drugs, and he hasn't been taking them for about 10 years now. He's clean, and he's pretty stable. I think he could do a good job. And I said, do I have any choice? Bob said, well, if you can get somebody that the studio will agree to at the same price. And I said, what's my budget for an editor? And he goes, basically, scale. And I said, well, can I search around? And he said, sure, you can search around. And I had thought about Walter Murch, who I had seen speak at LACMA, and as I said, I got his phone number from me and Bernie. And I contacted Walter, and he said he was interested in the project, and would Universal send a copy of the memo to him? So they sent a copy of the memo to Walter up in Northern California. About 3 days later, I got a phone call, and Walter said, can you come up here and have lunch? I'd like to discuss this project with you. So I got in my little Honda Civic and drove from Los Angeles to Northern California, north of San Francisco, and pulled into Walter's old farmhouse. I was greeted by Walter and his wife, Aggie, and his daughter, Beatrice, and they invited me inside, and we had a very, very wonderful lunch. And it was very homey. It's a beautiful house. This I will tell you, if you see The Unbearable Lightness of Being, and you see the house at the end of the film that's shot in America, that's Walter's farmhouse. And he also used it in a film that he directed, his only directorial effort, called Return to Oz. His whole area was used as a location for the film. So I was there in this picturesque location in a beautiful farmhouse, and Walter then brings out the memo, and he proceeds to read the entire 58-page memo to me, word by word, page by page, as only Walter could. And he puts the memo down, looks at me, and says, I'll do it. When do we start? And here I was, this filmmaker who had done maybe about 20 documentaries in the past, and had done some notable projects for The Doors and Sundance Channel, as I said. And all of a sudden, I had a green light with the Orson Welles project at Universal with Walter Murch as my editor, who had won 2 Academy Awards for The English Patient, won an Academy Award for Apocalypse Now, and was considered by most to be the most respected editor in the industry. And then he said, but I also want you to do me a favor. When I was in Europe, I showed a film class a copy of Raging Bull, and there was one shot in the film that was reversed from all other prints that we've seen. Do you think you can find out or contact Thelma Schumacher and find out what the origin of this reversed print is? Well, to this day, I can tell you I have not found the origin, and I've talked to Thelma, and Thelma doesn't know about a reversed print and everything else, but this was the kind of thing that Walter throws out in front of you. So all of a sudden, there I had Walter Murch on Touch of Evil. What was the next thing I had to do? I went back to Los Angeles, and they put me on a plane and sent me to Chicago to meet Jonathan Rosenbaum. And I sat down with Jonathan, and I explained to Jonathan that Walter was going to edit it. And Jonathan had reservations. He goes, well, you know, he's a commercial editor, you know, and he's brilliant, and you can't argue with someone that's that good. He might do what he wants. And I said, well, that's what I want for you, Jonathan. I want you to discuss with us what we're going to do and the ethical use of the re-edit. And Jonathan agreed. So then Jonathan became the consultant. So basically I had Jonathan Rosenbaum and Walter Murch as my partners on a Wells project. And believe me, it was a team effort. And I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out who the best guys in town would be to work on this project, but boy, was I lucky. I was the happiest kid in the candy store. And from that point on, everything seemed to be pretty much blessed with this project. One of the things that I did was when I was staying in a hotel one night, I called Wells cameraman Gary Graver on the phone. And Gary also gave me insight and a list of other Wells scholars like Joe McBride and some others that I should contact. And Gary and I had a great talk. I had originally met Gary in the mid-70s when I was working at a place on Santa Monica Boulevard called Raw Stock Film Exchange, where I was buying raw ends of film and selling them. And, you know, cinematographers would buy a 400-foot roll of film, and they would shoot 300, and they would sell me 100 feet, and then I would sell it to another cinematographer. And Gary was shooting a film for Ron Howard, selling the raw stock ends, and then using them on Orson Welles' film, filming Othello. And all these cinematographers would come in, but Gary was the only one who was generally nice and would spend time and say, hey, kid, you're going to make it in Hollywood, and if you really try. And basically, over the years, I lost touch with Gary. But through a friend, I think it was probably Jonathan, I got Gary's number, and I wanted to call Gary to find out, you know, basically if, you know, what Wells had thought about Touch of Evil. It wasn't that it was going to alter the change, but I was trying to get close to someone who really knew Wells. And Gary had shot The Other Side of the Wind and a lot of Orson's commercials. He was the cinematographer for a lot of F for Fake, and he was as close to Orson as anybody. And I became really good friends with Gary and his wife, Jillian, and Francesca and I would get together with them, and he would also have wonderful, wonderful dinner parties, and he did a lot of projects for me. But he was, as I say, he was always internally grateful for this film, and, you know, it always meant a lot to me. In the last year, unfortunately, Gary passed away. It affected me greatly. I heard from a friend that the last thing Gary did in the last moments of his life was he requested before he went on to be with Orson that he watch one more time Touch of Evil. And as I'm watching now Orson here, I think of Gary, and Gary was a great supporter of the re-edit of this film. He really, really meant a lot to me, and I have to talk about him in this commentary, and again, it's another emotional story. So, Gary, if you're listening to this commentary in heaven, I'm thinking of you. And I'm also thinking of Janet. Janet was mom when Francesca and I were in Cannes. It was interesting. She was just a classy lady. The studio said to Janet, we're going to take you here, and we're going to take you there, and we're going to show you this great time in Cannes. And Jonathan Rosenbaum was there at the time, and Walter and Aggie and Bob and his wife Nancy were there. And Janet looked at the studio head and said, but what about Walter and Aggie and Rick and Francesca and Bob and Nancy and poor Jonathan? I mean, the way the studio is supposed to do things is we all do it together. So basically, the studio wound up taking Janet Leigh and Entourage all through Cannes. And she was just an absolutely classy lady. And the same thing I have to say about Chuck Heston. When I got the LA Film Critics Award for this, Chuck Heston couldn't attend because he had a previous engagement. But he and his wife, Lydia, who he had been married to since 1946, came just to wish me well. And all of a sudden, they were at the cocktail party, and they said, well, we were driving by the hotel, the Bellage Hotel in Sunset, and we thought, oh, there's Rick in there, and he's going to get an award for Touch of Evil. We might as well go and wish him well. One thing I have to say about Chuck is, and he said it when we were in New York doing interviews, you know, he's two men. He was the man who was the film actor and one of the nicest guys in the world, and then he had his political beliefs. And all I can say about Chuck is, and I loved him dearly, and again, we've just lost him, is that he was like the uncle that you dearly loved, that you felt very, very close to, that you always loved being with, but really, you know, his politics were not yours. But he never made you feel bad. I had a few wonderful dinners with Chuck and a few wonderful lunches, and I can say that he never once mentioned politics with me. All he mentioned was film and his film stories. And he was one of the nicest men you could ever meet, and probably the nicest individual I ever met in Hollywood. And that is why that man worked as long as he did. If it wasn't for Chuck Heston, this film would not have been made, because Lou Wasserman was Chuck's agent, and he was Janet Leigh's agent. And it was Lou Wasserman who got Chuck the job on this film, and it was Chuck who insisted on Wells directing this film. It was a little MCA Universal family. If Chuck had not agreed to do this film, there would have been no Touch of Evil. So for those who complain about him being miscast or not appropriate for the film or anything, if he had not put himself on the screen, you would not have this movie, and you would be not watching this film today. So again, Chuck, we think of you, and we think of Janet, and we just want to say nice things about you guys, because they were all very much a part of the re-edit of this film. They got very involved. They supported it in every way. And another guy was Valentin de Vargas, who lived in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and came to L.A. and supported the original DVD release. And I mean, I couldn't believe one day I was standing there with Valentin de Vargas, Janet Leigh, and Charlton Heston in a movie theater on Wilshire Boulevard for the DVD release. And Valentin does not look, he looks older, but he, you know, he's still Poncho.
Just what about?
He's a tough rep, you get caught with his stuff.
It's only that Vargas thing again. Yes, ma'am?
Give me state 1212.
Very good, ma'am. State 1212.
Hey, hey, that's the police department.
Yeah? Huh? It's the police, all right. What do we do now?
We do nothing. We relax and have ourselves a ball. I'm very sorry, Mrs. Vargas, but the telephone is temporarily out of service. I'll call you just as soon as it's repaired. Better call Uncle Joe.
One of the interesting things about finding the Ernest Nim's notes, and I'm going to read something from that, and then I'm going to talk about the editorial history of this film, which I think we should address now. During the middle of editing, which this letter was probably written sometime in July or beginning of August of 1957, Wells writes, "Dear Ernie, with our new cutter, I've been trying out a new system of work, giving him the very fullest possible memos and leaving him alone to carry out the assignment without my breathing down the back of his neck." Then he puts, "I don't want another editor to freeze up on us." One of the things that always puzzled me as a young cinephile filmmaker, film fam, film geek, whatever I was how could a 42-year-old Orson Welles, the man who made Citizen Kane, make his last Hollywood film so incoherent and so basically disjointed? It never really clearly made sense to me. And probably for the first 20 years of my film career, I didn't even know about the memo. It wasn't until basically, I don't think anyone really knew much about it until Jonathan Rosenbaum wrote about it in the 90s in Film Quarterly. And that was brought to the attention to me from Alan Davio. How could a man who had Russell Meddy and Phil Lathrop and Phil Bowles on the film and make a film that was so disjointed and so incoherent? It just, it didn't make sense to me. And even when I saw the 72 version, it just seemed like a really bad film. How could a 42-year-old genius like Orson Welles make a film that was so visually exciting, so exciting to look at and so brilliant to see, and not make sense? It always puzzled me. Citizen Kane, I have to say, is one of my favorite films of all time, and I'm a big Orson Welles fan. And it just, you know, I loved Othello, I loved Macbeth, I love Magnificent Ambersons, I wish I could see more of it. The Stranger came out, and that was, again, Ernest Nims, who was the head of production, edited that film. Lady from Shanghai, all these films, brilliant films. Why was his last Hollywood film so incoherent? It was as incoherent as Mr. Arkadin. But we understood what happened with Mr. Arkadin. I was confused. And what I found was that Wells was right on the money when he directed the film. He directed every shot accurately. He was on time. He was on budget. His composition was great. All the elements were there. But Wells had a problem in the editing room. He liked to fiddle, and he liked to rework things. And he was a great storyteller. He knew how to write a narrative. He knew how to write a memo to explain what he wanted. But when he went into the room, people just froze up on him. They just didn't know how to handle the man. By August of 1957, Wells had basically worn out his welcome at Universal Studios. He basically got everybody really upset that, you know, he basically had put together a picture that they didn't understand, they didn't care about anymore, they just wanted to get out, they wanted to see their money. It wasn't a pretty picture. He screened the film in August of 1957 and then told Ernest Nimes that the next week he would send them a memo to explain what he thought should be changed. Unfortunately, Wells never sent them the memo. He just forgot, just disregarded the film. According to Ernie Nimes, they tried to contact Wells. Wells was off working on another picture. Wells didn't have time to come in. There were a million excuses. I think Wells just figured that they couldn't screw up his movie. It was too well put together. When they brought Harry Keller in, he was greatly upset, but he wasn't even allowed back on the set. So basically, he was barred from Universal for basically neglecting the studio and neglecting his own movie. It was not necessarily the studio's fault. It was Wells basically figuring that everything would work out fine. Why not? It did with Citizen Kane. When he wrote the memo, not only did he write the 58-page memo, but 2 days later, on December 7th, he broke down the memo and broke it down to 48 different sections to explain what should be changed. And the studio did abide to about one-third of the memo at the time of receiving it. They did make some of the changes Wells wanted, but I think they were overly confused by the picture. And they wanted to rush the movie out, and they wanted the film to just play and then just, you know, disappear. And basically, they had no even hope that it would be obscurely seen on television. They just thought that it would disappear. And they wanted Wells to disappear, too. Malt did not like Wells. And Nimes was basically exhausted with all, you know, everything he tried or what he thought he had done to try to do for Orson Welles.
The fun is only beginning.
Hank, I've been looking for you in every bar in town.
Yeah, I've been in half of them, only here on the wrong side of the border. I never drink on my own beat.
Bartender, give him some black coffee, quick.
I don't need He's black coffee. Meeting?
Vargas at his hotel.
Hotel?
No, right here across the street.
Well, I don't need any coffee, not yet.
Not yet. This is a swell time to be getting fried.
My job's over, Pete. You ought to be over to the park.
Now, listen, Hank.
Working on Sanchez. We got to break
Vargas is telling the chief and the DA that you planted that dynamite.
He was a fool.
They're taking him seriously. They came to him.
No, I mean Sanchez. Dynamite's no way to kill. Did I ever tell you the smart way to kill, Pete?
Sure, sure. Strangle.
Clean. Silent.
You told me all that.
That's
Come
how my
on,
wife
finish that coffee.
I don't usually talk about my wife.
Never when you're sober.
She was strangled, Pete.
I know.
Bind and cord. She was working up at the packing plant, so the killer had it right to hand. Smart.
Now, again, I would suspect, and I'm sure that you've heard a lot from the other commentaries about the history of Wells and the project and their interpretation, but I'm looking basically at the editorial end of it. In working with the memo, after I got up to Northern California with Walter, we were able to find just little tweaks and tweeners in the film that would basically be able to make the story more coherent. Except for the big chunk in the beginning where we had to do the cross-cutting, it was basically between leaving town and then getting to the Sanchez apartment that was major, because there were certain punctuation points that had to be told in the story. Wells was notorious for wanting to do little tweaks that would work. And this is what we found was basically our biggest task for the project. The other thing was the sound. on the project. Wells believed in going in and recording things after. He had spent a lot of time in Italy recently, prior to Touch of Evil, working on an Italian production where he knew that there would be actors from different countries speaking in different languages and that they would have to be dubbed. So Wells was a great believer in dubbing. Also, he knew it because of radio that he could dub. So he left a lot of that for granted. Richard LeGrand and Harry Snodgrass, who worked on the sound for us, spent hours and hours and hours cleaning up the out-of-sync ends that was in the previous versions of Touch of Evil. When you watch the preview version and the release version, watch how out-of-sync a lot of the dialogue is. Things had to be cleaned up, and that was basically, we spent probably more time cleaning up the sound on the project. Not changing the sound, but just putting it back in sync as the studio should have originally done, than we did in re-editing the project. The re-edit of Orson Welles' Touch of Evil only took about three and a half weeks. The sound and the picture, to get that back into shape, took almost 2 months. So that was a major task for this project, and that's again where Bob O'Neill comes in, and YCM Labs, with Eric Adler, who worked endlessly to time the film to give us a decent, if not an extraordinary looking print. Eric had come from UCLA archives where he had done a lot of restoration with Bob Goetz, so he really knew his business and he was able to make the restoration of the film look absolutely beautifully. So we can say, as far as the film, it's not a restored version in any way. It's just an attempt at the memo, but it is a restored visual element. We had the negative to work with on the release version, and we had a print on the preview version, and he was able to time both beautifully together. So what we're looking at right now is just, you know, a beautiful black and white film. Some think it's one of the most beautiful restorations of a black and white film ever. I have to concur, I've seen some other wonderful work, but this is absolutely an extraordinary job. And between Bob O'Neill and Eric and YCM, this is where their shining moments come in as far as Touch of Evil.
Men ready to give their lives.
Have you caused enough trouble? Are you satisfied? I want you to apologize.
To Quinlan?
And to Chief Gould.
Would you like me to get down on my knees?
If you have any decency, you will, yes. You'll crawl.
Mr. Adair, I won't give you the chance to test your authority in this matter.
Al, have I still any credit left with you?
Some.
Tell me, where can I find the records of Quinlan's old cases?
I'll show you.
I'd like to get back to my wife. I hope this won't take too long.
Hank, You're not going without this.
Coming up now is where one of Wells' shining moments comes in. This elevator right here. This was all dubbed in later. I mean, if you can imagine Phil Lathrop in this little elevator going down right now. There's no sound man in there, believe me. And this is, as I discussed with Wells, the way he worked in sound. Watch the lips.
Narcotics. He's a drug addict. He's got that young wife of his hooked, too. But good.
What I would say is, if you can go back to the release of the preview version, look at the same lips in the elevator, and you will see basically how out of sync, you know, they are. This is the kind of stuff that we did, not things that were done on Othello, which have been questionable, but things that we felt we could clean up that were ethical. And again, it was Jonathan Rosenbaum that we brought on. Jonathan was the one that if there was anything that was done wrong in a restoration, and he has talked about previous work, what he was displeased with, at least we had him on our side.
Just be careful, huh?
Chief, I'll be very careful.
This takes guts, Al, standing up to your boss this way.
I have read in recent books, one that came out from France, and occasionally I'll read something where people basically discount this film or sometimes not even include it. But a lot of times I read that they'll say, well, this is not Wells' version. But we never said it was Wells' version. We always said that it was a re-edit based on the memo And what we did was produce a film that gave us an idea of what Wells really intended versus what the studio had done. We were not trying to make Orson Welles' version of the film.
You've got your work really cut out for you.
Here's a scene that really shows you what happens. In the preview version, the release version, you see her look at this guy coming in. In the original versions, you see three people coming in the room. It makes it hokey. It looks like where Wells wanted it to be menacing and a serious look. Compare the two. Compare the preview and the release and this, where you only see Valentin de Vargas. You see the shadows. You cut to Dietrich, and this is important too. Old and new, Wells technology, the pianola, one of the oldest forms of home entertainment, and the television, 1958, something that's coming in brand new. Wells is telling you a lot of information at this time.
I'll be right there. Now, what would Hank Quinnan be doing?
And look at the hat.
Used to be he'd hole up at your place for 2 or 3 days with a case of whiskey.
That was years ago. Now he's on candy bars.
Not tonight, he isn't.
We understand Tanya's business even more poignantly at this point. Now, we cut to this room. We see Mercedes Cambridge coming in. Now, this is really scary. Those shadows are revealed to us. So it's not just a group coming into a room. You're feeling the tension of Janet Leigh, who said she was actually terrified in shooting this. I love this right here. I mean, that's a magic moment for Dennis. It's a scary scene, but it's definitely a magic moment.
Oh, and the watch.
Hold her legs.
Recently, I showed this film to an audience, and it actually got somebody in the audience laughed, and I've never seen the humor in this. And that's what Wells was concerned with, was bad laughs. Now, here comes the most, what I consider my most important decision of editorial change in the film. In the memo, Wells asks for a shot with Joseph Calera, who puts his head on the table to be removed. And I asked Walter to please, you know, do this shot. And Walter said to me, I'm sorry, Rick, but, you know, that's one thing I don't think needs to be removed. I don't think Wells really meant it. He was just writing something here. It was not what Wells originally would have cared about. I think we can keep the head on the table. And if you look at the preview in the release version, you'll see the head on the table. So I went back to my motel that night. And that night, all I could do was dream and see Joseph Clear's head on a table. Then that morning, I went for a walk in the Muir Woods. And it was a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful day. And the sun was shining through the big old trees. And it should have been perfect. And all I could see was Joseph Clear's head on a table. So that morning, I got in the car after my walk, and I went to Walter's. And it took me about a half hour to get there, and I kept on thinking about this head on the table. And I went to the barn, and Walter was there. And there was Walter in a bathrobe, hair mussed up. He had gotten up about 3 or 4 in the morning and thought about something he had to edit. And he just went, you know, this is the way Walter Murch works. It's 4 in the morning, he gets up, he puts on the bathrobe, and he goes into his room and starts working. And he looked really frumpy and grumpy. So here I was coming there to argue with him. And he looked like the last person in the world I wanted to argue with. And I said, Walter, we have to get this head off the table. And Walter said, no. And I said, Walter, you're Walter Murch. You can do anything. I mean, think of everything you've done. All you have to do is get a darn head off the table. And so he did it. And what we found out was it extended the character of Menzies. It made the Menzies character not as sympathetic. He doesn't collapse there. He still is defending his boss. And it makes his character throughout the whole film more important, before and after. This was a crutch. This was what was going to stop this character's motivations for the rest of the film. By taking the head off the table, he doesn't cave in yet. He doesn't give in, but he's not collapsing in defeat that, like, oh, my life's work is in ruin. And we were amazed. Walter wrote in great detail about this in the New York Times Labor Day edition 1998, for those who can find it on the internet, you know, in the New York Times archives. It was an amazing feat.
Register? Well, that might be cabin six.
Possibly.
Here's a cute little story for you guys, one of my favorite stories. After we showed Touch of Evil in Telluride, I got in a plane and I flew to New York. And I was going to do a day or two interviews in New York, and then I was going to fly to Toronto, where we were going to show the film at the Toronto Film Festival. And it was a rainy day in New York when I got there. I think it was night, actually. It was a rainy night in New York. And there was no car to pick me up, and it was like, you know, an hour and a half to wait for a cab. It was just an absolute mess. When you get into, you know, JFK Airport, you know, and it's teeming rain, try to get a cab, you know, into town. And I wound up developing a very acute state of laryngitis. And to some people, sometimes that's a blessing for me, that, you know, but basically, thank God I don't have it now for the commentary. And I went to Toronto, and I sounded like this. This is the voice I had. And I had to do 25 or 30 radio interviews discussing Touch of Evil. And I basically made it through that day, and thanks to Janet Leigh, who told me if I drank tea with some honey, that was an actor's trick, I would have some voice. So actually, while I'm doing this commentary, I'm actually, in homage to Janet Leigh, drinking tea with honey. I did that, and then we showed the film that night. And of course, I couldn't speak or say a word. That night, we had a dinner party, and at the dinner party, there was Brian De Palma at our table. It was a dinner party put together by October Films, who had released the film. And there were some critics from Baltimore and Toronto. And Janet was at the table, and we were chatting it up, except for me, who could not say a word. And Brian De Palma was sitting next to me. And, you know, of course, being the cinephile that I was, I thought this was going to be fantastic, except I couldn't say anything. So I was like this the whole time. And all Brian wanted to talk about was, where did we find this extra footage of Joseph Calera? Why was his character so extended? Why was there so much more of him? Why did he understand so much more of this guy? And it was basically what I discovered was, by taking that shot out, it made the character stronger. And by making that character stronger through the rest of the film, you paid attention to him in a much deeper way. And that was what Wells was intending, was to basically not lose that character that early on. So, again, a major editorial change in the memo that paid off big time and big bucks for this film. It was, you know, a godsend as far as a Wellesian decision.
Yes. Please.
Rancho!
Rancho Grande.
Yeah?
I love this when he enters Venice, because now we're getting a good look of what Venice probably looked like in 1958.
You got her under arrest?
Yeah, we have got her more reefer stubs around.
You kids didn't use none of that stuff yourself, huh?
Think we're crazy?
Nobody in the Grandi family gets hooked. Understand? That's the rule.
We blew the smoke in her clothes, that's all.
Like you said, we put on a good show to scare her.
Let's hope it was.
This, again, coming up, is one of the other most important shots in the edit. Originally, when you see Akim Tamroth strangled in this scene, they stay on the shot too long. They stay on the shot 2 or 3 seconds longer than they should, and it gets a bad laugh. And Orson wrote about this in the memo, that you can't stay on Akim that long. You have to, cut the shot, let it last only so long, because it's going to get a bad laugh. Let me read you something from that. And this comes from an earlier memo. This is not the 58-page memo, but this is a memo that Wells wrote sometime during production, and it's not dated. It's just a little long. My trip from the bed to Akim to choke him. After the first shot of Tamroth, with the first shot of Tamroth dead, use the same piece of Janet that is there now, but before she rises, then return to his face blown up so that the eyes are even bigger for a flash. Then repeat a moment on her and have her rise screaming. Basically, what he was trying to do was not create a bad laugh. When you see him in the preview and the release version, you see this head sitting there, and every audience that watched the film laughed because it was kind of like a grotesque Akim Tamroth who had, as we know, an animal's tongue in his mouth and his a fake eye bulging out, and it was like a very grotesque scene. But now, when you watch him in this scene, it's terrifying. It really is terrifying. To me, the scene in the motel is terrifying, but this is really a horrific scene that basically stands along with some of the stuff I've seen on television of recent times. Let's watch it.
Get the phone. The phone. Now dial 1212.
It's the police station.
Go on down.
Notice they're not saying 555?
Stop doing that. You're drunk. Just stop and think for a minute.
Same thing, answer.
Hello?
Ask for Sergeant Menzies. Menzies.
Sergeant Menzies. Quinlan, if you turn me in, I'll have quite a story to tell.
Yeah, you sure will. See it, Menzies.
Hello, Menzies?
Got it? Hand me the phone. Hold it so I'm talking. Give me the receiver. Give me the receiver. Hello, Pete. Of course it's me, partner. Any news yet?
The scientist still hasn't broken. What? Vargas' wife? A narcotics ramp?
One of the boys that was on.
Again, you see, Pete has not given in yet. With the head on the table, he would have been basically already a defeatist. Here he still believes in his boss, Hank Quinlan.
Control, don't be surprised what they find.
But what about me, Hank? What do I do?
Keep after him, break him! Break him! Put up the phone. Receiver. Give me the key. Told you I brought you up here for a reason.
Thank you.
notice how terrifying the scene is, but can you imagine it paying off with a bad laugh, as you'll see in the preview and the release version? It's truly terrifying. Favorite shots. And what Walter actually did was, not only did he shorten it, but he reversed it so that it was altered and played correctly to the light as the light ran in the room. Now, when you get to Venice, what Janet said, that she had to actually film in a real hotel and that there was some drunk sleeping on the bed in the room there. This was a nightmare, and it was supposed to be a nightmare. Coming up now will be one of the shots that they did honor with the memo, and a couple of the shots that I'll show you that the studio did listen to. One shot is at the end of here, you'll hear the word murder, and it's supposed to just kind of dissolve and fade out with Heston, not just cut to it, and it does do that. This bar does exist in Venice, California, and if you're touring around the old Touch of Evil Venice site, you can find it. In fact, you can find quite a few of the old sites. You can actually find out where the hotel is if you look around there. I mean, I can't explain to you in the commentary, but definitely it's worth exploring if you ever get to Venice Beach. You can do a Touch of Evil tour, and then if you really want to have fun, go out to Palmdale and see the other side.
Pues qué quieres, señor,
¿eh? ¿Dónde está mi esposa?
So you have to remember, when you're watching something like this now, isolated from other parts, you're actually watching exactly how Wells edited the movie. And that was something that was very important in our study of how to do the re-edit, was to watch his technique and his rhythm and his balance, and this plays out very well. This shows Wells in the top form. I mean, it's one of the most, in a way, enjoyable scenes in the film because it's really well choreographed.
Your wife.
And here we come with murder.
They picked her up.
What do you mean, picked her up?
The vice squad.
Quinlan?
You better come outside with me, amigo.
No, tell me what happened.
They found her at the Hotel Ritz, half naked on one of the beds, drugged. There were Reaper stubs and a heroin fix. Vargas! The charge isn't just possession of narcotics.
What is it, then?
Murder.
And here it is. See, that slight little optical that gives you this kind of eerie feeling as they run through the jail cells. Now, this is something that's important, too, about honoring the memo and also what we were able to do. If you notice, throughout the film, right from the very beginning, we've tried to stay with source audio. There's been no really underscores throughout the film. There's a little here and there, but not much. You hear a little bit during the murder scene with Grandi, but you don't hear that much. This is the first time that we really pick up and we hear a score that comes in that's not coming from a radio or a piano or anything else. And he really wants to set the mood. Also, Wells had written in the memo that there were too many shots of Menzies, And we were able to look at the memo and realize that those shots had been taken out. There were probably one or two extra shots there that they were cutting back and forth too much. So this plays out really well. This is, as I say, pure Wells, and this is where the memo has been honored. So this is another example of things that had to be changed.
Don't go.
I'm right here, Susie. It's all right.
Understand, Vargas, there's no formal charge against your wife.
Oh?
Even the vice versa.
And for a man who revolutionized ceilings in films, as he did in Citizen Kane and Magnificent Ambersons, this is a fabulous shot constructed in this room, which is really in the basement of the studio. And if the other commentaries haven't told you, of course, you might know that there was kind of a foul smell that somebody, an electrician or somebody, couldn't find a restroom and used that room as a restroom. And when they went to shoot and put on the hot lights, look at Joseph Clear's nose. Just watch him. That man wanted to get out of the room. Now, here comes one of the most, again, an important shot that we had to do in the memo. Again, here we have the old and the new, the television, the pianola, and the radio that's going to do him in, new technology. It's all in one, basically, area of the film. As we watch this play, let's watch how it builds up. One of the reasons I chose Walter Murch again was I love the work he did on The Conversation. And again, after watching this scene here with the radios, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out that Walter would be the right one for the project. I think this is one of the things that always grabbed Walter to this film, was that this was very similar to The Conversation as far as bugging and sound and everything else like that. The Conversation is still one of my favorite films. I wish Francis would make another film like that.
He says the kids were all faking. They
Here's the
antenna. Your wife and your real dope. The doc says it was only that true stuff.
Sodium pentothal.
Yeah, no harm in it at all.
No harm?
Schwartz is driving your car across the border. I told him we'll be by the bridge here. He's bringing your wife along. She's feeling fine. The doc says she can travel.
Sergeant.
Look, all she wants is to catch the early plane out of here.
How can I leave here until my wife's name is clean? Clean? What do you think you're carrying that microphone for? Now remember, don't cross your arms. I won't be able to get a word out. I've got to get the truth from Quinlan.
Yeah?
Untaped.
If I'm not talking right now, it's just because these last scenes, I think, are still, after everything we've learned about this film and everything I've discussed, I think are very important scenes to just pay homage to. They're just brilliantly executed and pure cinema. There are some people who make movies, and there are a lot of movies out there, and there are others that make cinema. And to me, this is true cinema.
Don't forget, I was the one that showed you that cane. I didn't have to do it, you know.
Oh, yes, you did, Sergeant.
Somebody could have planted it there.
Benzie.
Besides Grandy's corpse.
You know better.
It's hard to believe that this movie was made 50 years ago.
You know, why not Hank's cane?
You're an honest cop.
Sure I am. And who made me an honest cop? Hank Quill.
Come on, Menzies.
Alan Davio once told me he went to see the film when it first came out. It was playing in a second-rate theater on Ivar. And he saw the film 20 times.
What's my fortune?
What's very important is we did an edit at the end of this scene. Originally, If you look at the preview and the release, she looks at him and he walks off. In the re-edit, she looks at him one last time as he leaves the room, which really is much more poignant. It sets off that she knows this is the last time she's going to see him. Watch how this plays out in the re-edit.
Why don't you go home?
Vargas.
I don't know if you can hear me over the piano music, but I'll get him out of there so you can hear.
See how she looked at him? That one last look of Dietrich?
I must be drunk. A minute ago, I thought you were Vargas.
Come on out, Hank.
That's Marlena's sign-off to him as he leaves the room last time. That she knows it's the last time she's going to see Hank Quinlan alive, and she doesn't know what's going to happen.
Questions?
Another drink.
You had enough.
That's what Tana keeps telling me. How much is enough?
I have to say, what an amazing journey this film has been for me. It's been an extraordinary experience. 10 years ago, this project started, and it was released. And in the last 10 years, this film has never been forgotten. This film has played continuously someplace in some town, in some city, someplace in the world, almost every week since. And through this production, I have met extraordinary people, film directors, filmmakers, actors, actresses, people I would never have expected to have met in my lifetime, conversations that I would never have expected to have had. It's been an amazing, amazing adventure in cinema in all forms. If I could have only done one project in my lifetime, if there was only one film I could have been involved in or worked on, or one group of people I could work with, it would have to be this project. I mean, again, I can't say enough for Louis Viola and Mike Fitzgerald and Bob O'Neill and Janet and Chuck's wife Lydia and Gary and Jillian. Just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful people who really embraced this project and friends they made around the world in Italy, Germany, Brazil, New Zealand. Nanni Moretti distributed this film in cineplexes throughout Italy. It was what I was told at the time to be the most successful release or re-release of a classic film in Italian history. You know, other films have been released, preservation, restorations, but Touch of Evil drew the largest audience. I would be on a train in Italy with Francesca, and we would be talking to somebody who was not a, you know, basic cinema scholar or whatever, but had seen the film at the local Cineplex. It is an absolutely amazing journey, working on it right now, discussing this project with you and being able to share some of the stories of this project with you. It's been a great experience, and currently I'm writing a book for Wallflower Press on Touch of Evil that will be coming out next year, and this will give you much more detail into the history and the story and what we did.
Hank! You murdered Grandy!
I left my cane by his body. That was sure crazy.
All right. Let's start in the beginning. What about Vargas' gun?
I was talking about my cane.
The gun!
I forgot it.
The gun you stole from his briefcase. Gun? Vargas' gun! Vargas's!
Vargas! All you want to talk about is Vargas!
You took the gun from his briefcase, but you didn't use it.
Grandy was strangled.
Grandy was a crook.
You're a killer, Hank.
Fine, eh? I'm a cop.
Yeah. Drunk and crazy as you must have been when you strangled him. I guess you were somehow thinking of your wife, the way she was strangled.
Always thinking of her, drunk or sober. What else is there to think about? Except my job. My dirty job.
You didn't have to make it dirty.
I don't call it dirty. Look at the record.
One of the things I have to say, and again, I talk about Chuck Heston, film-wise, there's everything I love about Chuck, but this is something I have to say about cinema, is that he was involved with the NRA, and I've always found it interesting that in this film that his gun was stolen and it was used in a murder. I think that sends a little bit of a message. I did not like what Michael Moore did with Chuck, and Chuck had his rights to believe what he believed in, and he marched with Martin Luther King, with Marlon Brando, and I mean, he was a very good man and very religious man. But this is an example of a gun being stolen and used and killing a good man.
Like you planted that dynamite.
Don't you think Sanchez is guilty? He's guilty, he'll confess. Hey, listen to that.
Hank, I got the heft.
Shut up. Hear that?
Hear what?
Like an echo. Vargas? I got a feeling he's someplace around here. Close to me. I got a hunch.
Why, Vargas? Why should he...
You sound kind of nervous, Pete. No, I game leg. He's starting to talk to me. Vargas. Maybe he's tailing me with the bug. Recording. Hey.
Are you carrying a bug for him?
A microphone?
Don't lie to me.
All right,
doctor. You better give me that gun.
Where is he? Where is he?
How did you figure to frame Vargas with it?
Framed? Who's been framed? Where is he? Vargas?
Where is he? Hank, look, Hank.
I'm talking to Vargas now.
Vargas? You hear me? I'm talking to you through this walking microphone that you...
To work for me?
No, I ain't working for Vargas.
I'm working for the department, Hank. Better give me Vargas's gun. It's okay, here it is.
Give it to me. Vargas!
There's Vargas's gun. More significant editing change that's going to come at the end here.
Well, Captain, I'm afraid this is finally something you can't talk your way out of.
You want a bet? You killed him, Vargas.
Come on now. Give me my gun back.
You don't understand me. You killed Pete. The bullet is from your gun.
You think anyone would believe that?
They always believe me.
People asked me when I was a film student, what kind of film I wanted to make after I got out of film school. What kind of movie what I want to, you know, do. And all I said was, I want to make a film as good as Orson Welles. And I think this basically carried out my dream in a way that I never expected. I could never expect to produce or direct a film as good as Orson Welles, but to be able to honor Welles like this. Can you imagine? He wanted to make 10 more films for the studio. He was only 42, and this was the end of his Hollywood career. Could you imagine 10 more Touch of Evils? Could you imagine if we would have had 10 more Orson Welles films? It's like having 10 more Rembrandts, 10 more Picassos, 10 more Dalís, 10 more Matisse.
Schwartz! Is she there? Did you bring my wife?
She's in the car.
That's Menzies. He's dead. Quinlan's been shot, too. He's lying by the recorder. Down there. I've got it all on tape.
You sure you got enough?
More than enough. Go play it back. You'll see. Susie.
Mike.
All these years you've been playing me for a sucker. Faking evidence.
You'll notice that what happens in the preview and the release version is that Schwartz closes the radio before Welles falls in the water. Here, it's case closed.
It's all over, Susie. I'm taking
you. And Welles falls in. This was Welles' last request in the memo.
How many did you frame?
Nobody that wasn't guilty. Guilty.
Hank!
No, I ain't working for Vargas.
Vargas.
So who was guilty? Orson Welles for leaving the editing room? Or for the studio for never allowing him back? He lived in Hollywood for basically the remainder of his career. He lived on Stanley, right above Hollywood Boulevard. Not Beverly Hills, not Bel Air. And he got a lot of acting jobs, but they didn't let him direct again. What does it matter? He was some kind of director, wasn't he?
His famous intuition was right after all. He framed that Mexican kid Sanchez, but he didn't even need to. The kid confessed about that bomb. So, turns out Quinlan was right after all.
Isn't somebody going to come and take him away?
Yeah, in just a few minutes. You really liked him, didn't you?
The cop did. The one who killed him. He loved him.
Well, Hank was a great detective, all right.
And a lousy cop.
Is that all you have to say for him?
He was some kind of a man. What does it matter what you say about people?
Goodbye, Tanner.
Adios.
We all have our favorite directors. We all have our favorite films. But there was only one Orson Welles, and there's only so many Orson Welles films. This is Rick Schmidlin. I want to thank some of the people that were involved in this film. Janet, Chuck, Orson, thank you so much for everything you gave us. What a cast. And this was a B movie? Collins, Joe Cotton brought us back a little of our Citizen Kane loves to it, and our Ambersons. I love this one. As we know, Zsa Zsa was Al Zugsmith, the original producer's girlfriend. These were all the people who worked on the Douglas Sirk, the Doris Day, Rock Hudson films. This was the A-team. Henry Mancini's first score. Walter Murch, you're brilliant. You're fantastic. I love you. Bill Varney and Peter and Walter, can you believe working with that team? There's old Bob. Jonathan Rosenbaum, single card credit, yippee. Sean, fantastic. There's the sound guys coming up, great guys. Debbie Ross, did a lot of films with Walter, great credit there for her. Here's the YCM guys, there's Eric. Thank you, Alan. Thank you, Francesca. Thank you for watching the re-edit of Orson Welles' Touch of Evil.